Truth is, I thought it mattered. I thought that
money
mattered. But does it bollocks? Not compared to how people matter.
Welcome, mention and other fine folks, to the Sunday Dispatch of the Black Letter, where we contemplate thoughts worth thinking as we try to navigate through the topsy-turvy, upside-down world we find ourselves in, seeking greener pastures on the other side to helpfully come out healthier, wealthier, and wiser. And in order to do that, we need to make sense of the nonsensical. There's a lot of nonsense out there, as we well know. Have to peek back behind the curtain, beyond the smoke and mirrors. Today, we're going to take a look at the gold, potential for gold in the upcoming year, 2021. You know, also take a look at the Fed's balance sheet and generally America's debt. Things are not in great shape. Who knows what that means in the future? Some pundits have some ideas, but regardless, if you had more debt than your income, that would surely be a problem. So I think there's not going to be a good solution to this in any event. In Forbes, could 2021 be the year of gold? 2021 could well be the year of gold, they say. Gold trends at a recent 1910 per ounce is up 25% for the year, and there's still the potential for an election disaster or a non-peaceful transfer of power that could propel the metal even higher on the fear trade. Both presidential candidates have been making economic promises that are conducive to gold price strength. As those promises are fulfilled, and they likely will be in some fashion, gold will very likely surpass the record high of 2000 it set in August. Trump is promising the biggest tax cut ever, and Mr. Biden is promising a substantial stimulus package and certain economic policies. Either one of those policies will cost trillions of dollars, and alas, Treasury hasn't a single one of these dollars in its wallet to cover the expense. So, as is normal in America, Uncle Sam will go hat in hand to the bond market and beg for another lifeline from investors. The dirty little secret, of course, is that Uncle Sam is effectively bankrupt and investors aren't likely to recoup a meaningful real return on the money they invest in U.S. debt. Debt in America exceeds $27 trillion now, or 137% of the economy. Obligations for which the U.S. is already on the hook, entitlement programs, federal employee and veteran benefits, etc., means the country really owes more than $155 trillion, or nearly 800% of GDP. Here's a graphic you can have a look at. GDP, probably just below $20 trillion this year. 137% of GDP is the national debt. And including the U.S. funded liabilities, we're almost at 800% of GDP. I don't know how anyone with any sense of reality or basic understanding of mathematics can see how this ends well, frankly. I mean, just 137% of GDP. Once it gets over 130%, apparently, studies have suggested that it acts as an anchor or a drag on the economy, which means we're in for a lot of slow growth even after we get out of the negative growth of this pandemic. Uncle Sam will rely on his buddies inside Treasury to do his bidding by keeping interest rates near zero while stoking inflation by printing oodles of dollars. There really is no other way. America's already large economy can't expand nearly fast enough to pay down the debt, particularly when the U.S. must issue more and more debt just to keep the lights on and to pay interest on existing debt. An outright default on some of the debt, while certainly not impossible, seems unlikely given America's need to maintain the full faith and credit pledge backing its bonds. Very likely gold tests the 2500 level in 2021, a 30% gain from current levels. The metal could even test 2700. So, of course, gold and precious metal silver will do even better in a precious metal run like that. And 30% gain from current levels in a year is nothing to be sneezed at. Nevertheless, I think we're going to see Bitcoin probably by the end of the decade reach 100,000, as I've suggested, in which case you're probably looking at a 8 to 9 times return from where we are currently. So a much better return. As I believe, they recommend physical gold as the best way to play this. It has a year-to-date performance, as you can see. This is gold and DOC. I'm not sure what that is. Perhaps that's the Dow Jones or one of the stock indices. So there you have it. You know, precious metals and cryptocurrency, particularly Bitcoin at this stage, I think are the best bets. As we probably are heading into a correction here, we'll have a look at the markets. I think they were down quite deeply last week. And I think this might be the start of the ongoing correction that will probably take us through to 2022 or so. And I mean, unless another black swan comes, I don't see a big, huge drop, but I think a slow erosion and a slow rolling downhill. The stock market's probably losing 50-60% or more of their values, the recent highs, over the next 18 months or so. We'll have to see. And Bitcoin, I think, of course, is going to do best. Gold, silver, of course, as well, if that's your preference, but Bitcoin for sure will be the winner. None of this is financial advice, just my own personal opinion. From Mises Institute, the Fed's balance sheet may be headed to $40 or $50 trillion. President Trump has said often that he had created the greatest economy the world has ever seen until the China virus came. Maybe some people believe that, but if the economy was so great, why did the Fed keep interest rates at zero and its balance sheet at $4 trillion? And that's a very fine point. In fact, what that suggests is that this economy was just boosted by hopium and 0% interest rates and borrowing and debt, which is now coming forth to be seen for what it really is. And it's going to be an anchor dragging the economy down for years, perhaps a decade or more to come. The president is bragging about the third quarter GDP bump. However, as David Rosenberg tweeted, even with the quarter three GDP snapback, which we saw at about 31% the other day, a snapback that is now stalling, 2020 likely goes down with a minus 4% print, by far the worst year for the economy in the post-World War II era. So really, I mean, a robust economy has interest rates probably at historical averages of maybe 6-7% for mortgages, et cetera, et cetera, and maybe around that for long-term treasury bills, you know, but we didn't have it. We haven't had that in years, perhaps a decade or more. So really, this has been just an economy that's been pumped up like a balloon on hopium that's now coming to pop or deflate. There were the good old days when the Federal Reserve's balance sheet footed to all of $800 billion in assets. In November 2008, the depth of the Great Recession, the Fed assets exploded to over $2 trillion. By 2015, Fed total assets had reached $4.4 trillion. Of course, when coronavirus hit, Fed assets popped to over $7 trillion. Some people predict $10 trillion by year end of 2020. Who knows? It's certainly possible. Felix Zuloff from Zuloff Asset Management told Grant Williams and Peter Fleckenstein on the Endgame podcast that the government can't absorb higher rates. Of course not. He said the world's central banks must take whatever paper governments issue. The result, by the end of the decade, will be a Federal Reserve balance sheet totaling $40 to $50 trillion, which probably at that time will still be about double the total output of the GDP. Negative rates will continue in Europe, leading to nationalization of the banks. The same will happen in the US, with real interest rates being negative for years to come. Negative rates punish banks, as Zuloff said. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. I don't see that as being a bad thing. If we can get off the dollar standard and just have our own personal banking apps, maybe from the Federal Reserve, I think probably that's the end game here, is that CBDC, right, that we've been talking about, the central bank digital coin. And so perhaps, you know, your employer will just deposit directly into your Federal Reserve or central bank app where you store all your money. And that way it's easier to control the negative interest rate. So you spend it or you start losing it by pennies per day or something like that. It's very easy to do. And of course, that's easy also to include a UBI. It gets rid of the banks, which have been nothing but pariahs on society, in my opinion. It's been a long time since they actually were a benefit and giving small businesses loans and entrepreneurs that are actually doing good things. But who knows? That might not happen. We'll see. And then, of course, you can just send your money from your wallet app into Bitcoin, which is what I would do to prevent the erosion of my money through negative interest rates. At least that's one outcome, perhaps a dour outcome, but I think it's certainly a possibility. All right, let's take a look at the debt. Charting America's debt, $27 trillion and counting. The visual capitalist has great charts here, as you can see. Why America's debt doesn't start growing. Since the global financial crisis, America's debt has often grown at a faster rate than GDP. By April 2020, the national debt had surpassed GDP by almost 18%. And you can have a look at this chart. Really, the global financial crisis, U.S. debt surged by trillions. You can see the big increase here. And now another big increase here as well. GDP at about 19.5 trillion. And of course, we're way beyond that now. And here's the federal spending and revenues. There was only budget surplus briefly, according to this, during the Clinton years. And then since then, it's been increasing, shrinking a little bit, but now increasing. I think this part here is optimistic. I think it's going to maybe head like that, but we'll see. I mean, just we're in very dire situations, and of course they need to do big spending, but of course that's not going to the right people. It needs to be going to John and Jane Doe on the street. Here's a closer look at federal spending and revenue, and as you can see, there's a deficit here, which just can't be increased unless they start increasing income taxes. But of course, individuals pay plenty as it is. Payroll taxes, corporate income taxes are a relatively small contributor to federal revenues. This is where there's room to start taxing corporations higher, especially the larger corporations like Apple and Google. I think they need to be double that amount, frankly. And then, of course, here's all the mandatory spending, health programs, social security, income security, federal, civilian, military retirement, and other, as required by law, as it says here. And this is determined on an annual basis by Congress and the president, which is discretionary. And look at this defense at 15%, because America wants to be the policeman of the world. I think that should be cut in half, frankly. And America should start working within the WHO and NATO alliance in order to help police the world rather than unilaterally get involved. But there you go. That's a huge amount of money. You can have a look at this chart. Links in the description below. It's very interesting. You can see that America's debt versus GDP. So for a while, it didn't seem too bad. In fact, during the early 2000s, when Clinton, I think, was in power, it sort of shrank slightly from the years before. But of course, look what happens here. In 2013, we get to 99%. I think that was during Obama's last term. And now we're just well above 100%. There's no turning back now. It's just going to get bigger and bigger. And here's what's preventing the debt from shrinking, obviously, is the budget deficit. Surplus in 2000-2001, end of Clinton years, I think, as I mentioned earlier. And then we've never seen a surplus since then, as you can see by scrolling through. And of course, right now, $3 trillion deficit. And federal spending, of course, which we've kind of looked at, discretionary spending, defense at $677 billion. That's just obscene, frankly, to be spending so much money on war and preparation from war during peace times. It's quite crazy. All right, so there you go, folks. Interesting chart, of course. Have a read of it to yourself and see what you can glean. But it's certainly worrying and troubling. We'll see how we get out of this. And I'm sure we will remain hopeful and optimistic. You know, Western democracies have always bounced back from difficult periods. But I think it's going to take some bootstrapping for sure. All right, let's take a look at the markets and see how they did over the past week. Okay, so quite a catastrophe here. As you can see, the S&P 500 down almost 5% on the week, down 479 basis points, so 4.79%. The NASDAQ, interestingly, I thought it would be down more than the S&P 500, but it's not. It's only down 4.7%, 470 basis points. But still, that's quite a shellacking for 1 week. We haven't seen those kind of numbers for quite some time, possibly since the dip, I think, in late September, or maybe even the March crash. I'm not certain. And the Dow Jones down almost 6% at 576 basis points, or 5.76% down over the week. So doing the worst. And we'll take a look at the Russell 2000 for the overall market. And the Russell 2000 also down almost 5.5% at minus 5.29%, or 529 basis points. I wonder if the dollar index has been up over the week. Let's have a look. And there you go. So people are flying to the safety of the dollar, obviously, with the stock market correcting. So the dollar up 1.36%, not huge, but you know, dollar indices and Forex doesn't move very fast. And there you have it, 1.36% positive, or 136 basis points. I wonder if gold and silver have done as well. So gold actually down almost 1.25% for the week, down 1.24%, or minus 124 basis points. Silver probably more than that will be down. Let's see. Yeah, and silver down almost three times as much, I think, at minus 3.83%, or negative 383 basis points for the week. So there you have it. Everything down pretty much except for the dollar index. But let's take a look at Bitcoin, see how it has done over the past week. Okay, so for the past 24 hours, 2.8% increase. We're above 400 billion market cap right now at 408 billion. 5,994 coins available for your purchase and pleasure. And Bitcoin dominance increasing at 62.6%. And that's usually, I think, the start of a bull move when Bitcoin dominance increases. And then the altcoins probably increase towards the end of the bullish move. So we'll have to see if that remains true. But the last 7 days, you can see the Bitcoin has been up 6.7%. So the best performing asset probably over the last week, probably over the last year to date, and certainly over the past decade. Ethereum down almost 5% for the week. Bitcoin creeping up on 14,000, so it's doing well. This might be the start of a slow move towards the most recent high. And then, of course, I think that was at around 18, 19,000, if I'm not mistaken. And then, of course, back from there, we will get to a place where after that, it'll just sky's the limit, really. And that's where we could get towards six figures, I think, towards the end of next year. Let's see if that pans out. So the rest of the coins in the top 10 basically down, as are some of the Bitcoin wannabes, Bitcoin Cash and Litecoin and Bitcoin SV. So your winner, folks, is Bitcoin. And if you want to dabble a little bit in altcoins, then I would stick to Ethereum. I think many of the others will not do well long term. Of course, there's lots of money to be made in the interim if you know what you're doing. But for me, I'm just going to stick to my cooking, which is Bitcoin. I still have some Ethereum too. I also have a little bit of XRP, some Polkadot, some Chainlink, I think I might have. What else? Stellar, potentially. And I think I got some Uniswap, as we know, that was given to me. And Uniswap's going to Nowheresville. Rex City, maybe. All right, on to the online oracle for today's most pressing question. Okay, so I think it was the second article we had a look at. We saw here that according to Zulov, believes that the Federal Reserve's balance sheet could total 40 to 50 trillion by the end of the decade. And I thought that's an interesting question to ask the online oracle, our trusty sidekick, the 8-Ball Economist. So my question for the Magic 8-Ball is, will the Federal Reserve's balance sheet reach 40 trillion by the end of this decade? It is certain. There you go, folks. So it's an agreement with Zulov, and I can see that certainly happening if we haven't already reset by then somehow, which I think is the only other option, because these just become silly numbers at that point. Oh, just ridiculous. And there you have it, folks. Thanks so much for joining me. I appreciate you and hope you're having a wonderful weekend. Remember to stay healthy out there and compassionate and peaceful. We're still doing difficult times right now. We'll be probably for the next 18 months, 2 years, as we sort of settle to the bottom of this and then start the slow creep upwards. So I think next year is probably going to be a difficult one as well. With that said, remember, above all else, dumb Spiro, Spero.